Pretty much everyone agrees civic education is important. But why? And what exactly does that entail? Hello, welcome to The State We're In. I'm Melanie Plenda. Today we're talking about a new initiative to foster civic education in the state. Here to discuss what's going on is New Hampshire Secretary of State David Scanlan and Lily Wu, the state's Civic and Voter Education Coordinator. Welcome to you both.
It's great to be here. Thank you.
So first, let's talk civics. Secretary, how would you define what that is and why it's important?
Well, civics is a basic understanding of our government. And from my perspective, state government is just very, very important. Every citizen of New Hampshire has the opportunity to participate in their government, and they do that through their right to vote. And if they are a registered voter, then they also have the right to run for office. And that process is integral to our society and the way that it operates. So it is really, really important that that system function very, very well.
Excellent. And Secretary, tell us about the role of the Civic and Voter Education Coordinator and what you hope comes from it.
Well, in my experience in government, which has spanned over several decades in a number of different areas, there just seems to be a general decline in confidence that voters have when they go to the voting booths. Along with that comes a lot of misinformation and disinformation that is out there flowing around and is becoming more and more prevalent through the use of social media and the sophisticated and technical ways that we have to communicate today, as opposed to the way we communicated even 20 years ago. That coincides with a decline in the knowledge that voters have about how their electoral system works. And while I have spent a lot of time over the last 20 years helping to educate poll workers and the individuals that are engaged in the actual process of conducting elections, I find now that it is really important that we reach out to voters and educate them on the processes as well. Most voters, when they go to their polling place, they check in, they receive a ballot, they mark the ballot, and they turn it into the moderator. And then they leave the polling place. What they may not be aware of when they go through that process is the many checks and balances that are built into our system that help guarantee and make sure that their votes are accurately counted and that the process is working properly. We have to take the time to help our voters understand that. And the way we do it is be more transparent and educate the voting public, not only when they go through the polling place, but at every opportunity that we have when they engage in their civic government. So that's why I believe it's important that we have this position now of civics and voter education outreach coordinator, so that we can be proactive in reaching out to students and groups and everyday citizens about how our governmental system works and why it is important that they understand that process and participate in it.
So it sounds like this is a way to counter, in one way, to counter misinformation and disinformation about the government and election process. Is that right?
Well, the way we counter misinformation and disinformation is to provide accurate information to the extent that we can and let voters know where their trusted sources of information are. And in the case of elections, it's their local election officials, it's the Secretary of State's office, it's the Attorney General's office. And those are the reliable sources of information.
And am I right to think that, I mean, this position, obviously, it sounds like it's going to last well beyond the election. This is going to be an ongoing effort. Am I correct in that?
this is going to be an ongoing effort, and it is going to take some time to ramp up. And Lily can talk about what she has been doing, but it is really important for us to understand what type of education we need to do. And so Lily has been going out and talking with groups, election officials, and asking them what areas they think that voters need to know about the election process, and then reaching out to voters and finding out what they believe they need to know about the process. We can put together a plan in terms of curriculum for the school systems, and then a plan to just reach out to general groups that are active in the area of elections and start to communicate those areas that will improve the process.
Yeah, Lily, let's turn to you. I'd love to know how you are finding the role, and tell us more about what you've been up to. And I'm so curious if you have thoughts on whether you think that if this education is being presented when it's actually not in relation to an upcoming election, when things tend to be a little fraught, you know, when it's actually presented over time and outside the context of the politics of it, if it might actually be more effective in that way and that people might trust it a little bit more. But definitely tell us what you've been up to.
Yeah, so I'd say, first of all, not having a blueprint has been a bit challenging. I think, as the secretary mentioned, I think the atmosphere is very fraught right now with misinformation, disinformation, and that is challenging. But I think with all of these challenges, I think there comes excitement for the opportunity to be part of a team that that works hard to be proactive and that combats the misinformation, the disinformation. You know, I think as a former teacher, it's ironic to me that we teach our students to hand in work that is theirs. We teach our students to do the right thing when nobody is watching, you know. And so the excitement of this position is to be part of a team that combats the misinformation, the disinformation, and the artificial intelligence that's out there. And I think that's pretty common. With challenges come opportunities. One of the things that I really enjoyed was being part of the election training and talking to the election officials out there and hearing from them what they're seeing in the public, and eventually putting together a curriculum that will address the issues that the election officials are bringing up.
And what are some of those things that the public is saying that they're seeing, and what are those issues that they're raising right now?
Yeah, I think they're issues that can be as foundational as what do you need to register to vote. I think they can be issues that are more complex, like what are you allowed to wear in a polling station, to when can I change my party affiliation. You know, there's a primary election, there's a general election, and the rules are different for each, to a certain extent, you know, not vastly different, but there are things that are different. And so I think there are issues that certainly we can help to educate the public on, that will help the election officials be able to concentrate on having a polling station that is run efficiently, and eliminate all of those layers of having to repeat the answers to the same questions.
Right. And Lily, you mentioned the curriculum. What are your goals for developing a curriculum about civics?
Yeah. I think anytime you develop a curriculum, you always have to begin with the end in mind. And I think in this case, you begin with an end in mind of, I like to think of two pillars, the one pillar being the foundational elements of civics, which is individual rights, the rights guaranteed in the Constitution, the rights guaranteed in the Bill of Rights. And then I think that other pillar of civic responsibility. And so if you begin with that end in mind, the other piece you need is the why. And you need that thread of why. And if you can get to the foundational elements of what does it mean to be a citizen with individual rights, you can start to give students the tools to combat the misinformation and the disinformation. And so that's a thread that runs through. if you can give students a foundation to what it means to be civically responsible, well, then you give them a tool to be good citizens in society. And then ultimately, that's going to hopefully build trust in foundational systems that have been the bedrock of communities and have been the bedrock of this country.
And Lily, what is essential, do you think, for a civics curriculum, and how will something like that be implemented across the state?
Yeah, I think, you know, you always go back to roots. And I think one of the things that is most essential in a civics curriculum is the understanding of how we got to where we are today. And so it's understanding the past so you can have that knowledge to enter into conversations and not necessarily talk over each other or through, but with. So I think that, and also the foundational element of how you can be engaged. You know, the secretary mentioned certainly voting, that is engagement. It's the gift this country gives every one of its citizens through birth or naturalization. But I think also a foundation is how to be a contributing member of your community. And I think those are essential skills that we need to make sure students understand when they graduate, and also keep repeating that message to various sects of the public.
And do you have a sense yet? I know it's still early days, it sounds like, but do you have a sense of how it will be implemented across the state?
I think implementation is something that comes when you've brought in the various organizations that are already established, you know, such as the Department of Education, I think the New Hampshire Association of School Administrators, principals, school boards, certainly teachers. And so I think if you've brought all of those voices to the table during the curriculum creating process, I think implementation will look different depending on what the needs of the community are and what community members, teachers, schools feel is important for their population of people.
And this question is for both of you. So how do you feel this will help educators? And Lily, why don't we start with you?
Yeah, I think being an educator myself, I think it's not just about handing a school curriculum and saying, okay, you know, have at it. I think there are a lot of factors that go into being in front of a body of students, whether it's 15, 25, 35. And so I think knowing classroom teachers have a resource here, knowing that I understand what it is like to be in a classroom, I hope is helpful to educators.
Yeah, this is really a multi-stage program. And the curriculum part of it is the long-term planning and how do we get a program, a solid program that school districts can use around the state to teach students in the classroom. But beyond that, there are other groups out there that are important to this process and important that we reach out to them as well. And so we have some initiatives going where we've been working with veterans groups to try and get out and communicate with veterans. They already know about civics because they have sacrificed for our country in different ways. And we want to pull from that experience that they've had and the respect that they have in their own communities and try and engage them to become participants in the election process in terms of helping at the polls and other things. We had a great I voted sticker contest that was in the school system. That's something that we can continue as a program. And that's kind of a short-term initiative, but it generates tremendous interest and gets students engaged at a very early level. There may be other things that we can do, like essay contests in the higher grades. There are some awards that we can issue that are sponsored by national organizations like the National Association of Secretaries of State to young adults, whether they're high school seniors or college students or even slightly beyond that, to recognize individuals for their efforts in the community that have engaged in a civic way. And we're going to try and do more and more of that so that we're active immediately in trying to engage the communities, but then also work on a long-term solution to just increasing the general awareness of civics participation, starting in our school systems, and then, you know, through adulthood.
And that leads to our next question, which is also to the both of you. How will this help students and or the general public? Secretary, let's start with you this time.
Well, the idea is just to help students and the general public understand things about the election process that they might not know, that if they do know, will give them confidence that we have a great system in New Hampshire, and that because of that, you should have confidence in the results of the elections. And to let them know that the opportunity is certainly there for them to become active participants in that process, so they can see firsthand and experience firsthand how these systems work and understand the checks and balances that are at play. And if we can encourage adults and voters to do that, then I think the misinformation part is going to take care of itself. That when people become aware and knowledgeable, it is less easy to fall victim to incorrect facts out there about the election process itself.
And Lily, what about you?
So, I think, one of the things that I know this office and I know the secretary is very keyed in on is recognizing and acknowledging when students, when the public is engaged in the civic process. And so I think, if we can continue building the foundation for students and creating civically literate graduates who enter into this world, hopefully that spirit of engagement will continue and will carry on for a lifetime, whether it is volunteering at the polls on their election day or whether it is continuing to look out for neighbors, be part of the community, that everyone's moving in the same direction toward the public good. I think that's something that, when everybody's rowing in the same direction, good things are going to happen.
So here's another question for the both of you. As we approach the election, what would you like people to know about the process as it stands right now? And actually, Secretary Wendt, we start with you.
Well, New Hampshire has a unique system in terms of its elections. And what makes it unique is the fact that we elect our local election officials at the local level. So people's neighbors, their peers, family, and friends are actually the ones that are running the election, the polling place that voters will go to in that community. And those individuals are elected because people have faith in their ability. They believe in their integrity and their honesty. And that goes a long way in giving some confidence. Because of that, we have a very human process too, and errors can be made. I mean, people can make an error in adding numbers together when they're reporting final results. But our system is built to withstand that. Because it is easy to request a recount in the state. We now perform audits of ballot counting devices and things like that. And so while the system was not designed to be perfect, it was built to accurately reflect who won an election when the dust settles. And New Hampshire does a great job at that. I mentioned that there are checks and balances at play in the polling place, and some of those involve the political parties themselves are allowed to make appointments on participants in the polling place. And the best example of that are the inspectors of election, which are more commonly known as the ballot clerks. Those individuals are the ones that hand a ballot to the voter when they're checking in, while the other individual crosses the name of the voter off the checklist. That's usually a Republican and a Democrat sitting side by side engaging in that process. So not only can they keep an eye on each other, but they can also see what is going on in the polling place itself. And it's those checks and balances that are really important to just making sure that the system works properly. At the end of the night, when the moderator announced the results, the ballots were all packaged up and placed in boxes with security tape. There's a seal that is placed over those boxes that has to be signed by the selectmen in the town. And those seals are not broken unless there is a request for a recount or a court orders a ballot box to be opened up for some reason. So those are the things that we need voters to understand and become aware of. And that's part of the importance of the program that Lily is engaging in right now. It is also important for voters to understand the three different branches of government and the role that each plays in the process of elections. That's something that people are becoming less and less knowledgeable about. And it's time that we reverse that trend and make sure that people understand that the judicial branch of government, the executive branch of government, and the legislative branch of government all have really important roles to play in our democratic process.
And Lily, how about you? What would you like people to know about the process as it stands right now?
So, having gone on the election training, I don't want to say tours, but having gone with the election officials, having gone with the election trainers from this office and meeting with the election officials in the different towns across the state, what I would want the public to know is, as the secretary said, these people are your friends and your neighbors, and they are the ones that are making the process as efficient and as comfortable as possible for everyone. And I think the public needs to know that, as somebody said to me at one of the trainings, New Hampshire is working hard to do it right. And I think that is something that it's a credit to the office here that is training the officials. I think it's a credit to the election officials. And I think it's a credit to the patience of the public that if something is not going right at the election polls, well, it's not a time to I catch a moment. It's a time to find the moderator and to ask the moderator questions about what is going on. But I think, as the secretary said, there's a checks and balances built into the process. And I think certainly voters should go in confident that New Hampshire is getting it right.
So finally, you both have an interest and, dare I say, an affinity for civics. So where do you think it came from and how was it fostered in your life? Secretary, let's start with you.
Well, I have always had an interest in just participating in community activities. When I got out of college, I really had no desire to participate in government. But when I moved to New Hampshire with my first job, really a new adult in the real world, I just started engaging in activities that were based in the community. And that led me to run for office, a small office. I mean, I started with the local conservation commission working on local environmental issues. And that resulted in eventually running for the planning board, which was a little bit more involved and based in science and regulation. And that led me to run for the legislature at one point. And so it is something that kind of grew. And there was it seemed like one step led to another. And I think that is what we would like to see any interested person do. You don't have to start big to be involved in your community. You can start small, and you can do it. It doesn't have to be in government. It can be your local church group or you know, working in a youth sports league as a coach, and just participate in your community. It's really, really important. And if you have a desire, participate then in government. And use the example where I started. You don't have to start big. Just be a participant. It's really, really important. And you, and the work that you put in really impacts your community in positive ways. And if you have the desire to move beyond that, I just strongly encourage it. That's how our not really our just our government, but how our whole culture works. It's how our society works. And you get out of it really what you put into it. And it is rewarding work. That's why I've continued to do it over the years. And it's why I really love doing what I'm doing now.
And Lily, how about you? How was this fostered in your life?
Yeah, I think, you know, I'll key in on what the secretary said. It started really small, started really local. You know, I grew up in a family where both of my parents supported reaching out to the community. And so it was as simple as my mom rounding up as many of us as she could and sending us over to the neighbor and having us rake the lawn of our neighbors. They were an elderly couple. And, you know, it's things like that that are small, but it fosters that spirit of engagement. And, you know, I think what the secretary just said about you will get out of it exactly what you put into it is so true. And the more we can encourage students, the more we can encourage people to be active in the process, well, good things are going to come. And, you know, nothing is ever too small to participate in. You never know how it's going to land on someone in a way that helps them see, I think, the value of being engaged.
Well, you two have a lot on your plate, especially in the coming weeks, and we so appreciate you being here. Good luck with all of these endeavors.
Thank you.
Thanks so much.
Thank you. Secretary of State David Scanlan and Lily Wu, the state's Civic and Voter Education Coordinator. The conversation continues online. What do you think of civics education in the state? We'd love to hear from you. Visit your favorite New Hampshire PBS social media channel and use the hashtag NHCivics. Today's episode was produced by Rosemary Ford. The video editor is Raul Botha. Thanks to Dr. Kristen Nevius, Violet Shuttler, and the entire team at the Marlin Fitzwater Center for Communication at Franklin Pierce University for recording this episode. Finally, thanks to the New Hampshire Charitable Foundation for general operating support of this series. I'm your host, Melanie Plenda, Executive Director of the Granite State News Collaborative. I hope you'll stay connected to the state you're in.